So it's my pleasure to introduce to you the people who are going to do session 11 for us. Kaja Sadowski, on the right here. Again, as I mentioned earlier, those of you who were at Cork may have seen Kaja add with a paper at this very conference 6 years ago. Kaja and her fellow instructors from the Valkyrie Martial Arts, the Western Martial Arts Assembly, Randy Packer and Jordan Both, are going to be giving us an introduction today, an overview, and in more than an overview, in fact, some close focus work on what we know about sort of medieval English sword fighting and how that might actually help us think about romance. Yeah. Okay, so Kaja, I'm going to hand it over to you guys to do your thing, and I will retreat. Retreat is the act.
Over to Randy to start, who's going to give us a quick primer on our methodology, how we know what we know about medieval swordplay, and how we do some of our own interpretation of our source texts.
Cool. Okay, so what we know about medieval martial arts in particular comes from three primary sources. We have the I-33 fight book, which is recently residing in the Tower of London. Johannes Lichtenauer's The Recital, which is a very complex little poem, and Fiore de Liberi's Flower of Battle. These are lovely books we discovered 30, 40 years ago. Well, got some martial arts movies. The first one, the one most relevant, is the Royal Armoury's archive, also known as the Valkyrie's fechtbuchs. We think it was written around 1320. This book is a lot of fun. It shows a group of priests teaching young people, students, and clients a very complex martial arts system called the Swords and Shields. Exciting find. This is the earliest known martial arts manual in Europe. One of the earliest known martial arts manuals in the world, not counting the Egyptian one. There's frequent references to existing martial arts practices. So we know that this was a recording of a tradition that existed before this book was written. We know that we'll get into a little bit of detail later, but basically they describe things that are common to the martial arts and they give solutions to those common things that they do. This book was relatively popular, reprinted well into the 16th century. Following the Tower of Fechtbuchs, the next one we have is the works of Johannes Lichtenauer. We know nothing about him. Literally nothing. We don't even know when he lived. Most of the work that references original recital includes a little, you know, God rest his soul bit, except for the very earliest one, but they may have just forgotten to write that in. So anywhere from late 14th, early 15th century, somewhere along those lines, we're still trying to find more of it. The primary work he wrote was really comprehensible. It was intentionally encoded. So we had no real code. It was a martial arts instruction manual, aside from later students of his who went on to become martial arts instructors themselves, wrote extensive glosses that explained the system. And that's how we know Lichtenauer's work, is through the glosses of all of his students. He became the part of a huge German tradition that extended into as late as the 18th century. They were still doing two-handed sword fighting in Germans. Yeah, which is the main crux of his work is, unlike I-33, which is sword and buckler work, Lichtenauer teaches two-handed sword work and a little bit of single-handed sword and some counter combat work as well. Moving from Germany down to Italy, we have Fiore de Liberi, Fiore the Free. Born in the 1340s, he's our first actual knightly martial artist that we know of. He wrote Flower of Battle in the early 1400s. He was a really neat guy who apparently had not a lot of impact going forward, but he wrote some beautifully illustrated manuals. His students wrote beautiful manuals too, and then they just disappeared. The art historians found them and said, look at the pretty pictures! Hold on a minute, that's really good stuff. Let us see that. He had quite a reputation. His job was to teach his students to prepare fighting duels and passages of arms. The Duke of Milan was one of the students who famous to hold him. One of the marshals of France fighting a mercenary captain in Italy as well, a really well-recorded duel. He himself covers, how to cover, how to defend yourself against someone trying to stab you in the back when you're sitting in church. Apparently a big thing at the time. Swords of one hand and two hands, spears, axes, mounted combat, combat one person against many people, and includes things like how to prepare a special herbal concoction to put into a fake poleaxe head, so that when you're in a tournament, you can fire your poleaxe at someone and align them with the power. Yeah, it's good stuff. Okay, so moving forward to our modern study, how we've chosen to reinterpret this stuff, which is the choice to reinterpret it. We started probably, I think the real drive was maybe 25, 30 years ago. It's been a few years, I forget exactly how long it's been. But there were a lot of enthusiasts in the Society for Creative Anachronisms, quite big. And other reenacting groups started to collect some of these manuals, and there was a small group of people that were like, hey, look, there's, we don't have to pretend martial arts fighting from the Middle Ages, we can actually find it. They started photocopying things and passing them on amongst each other. There was quite a little circuit of multiple photocopies of people running all over the place. We're lucky in Vancouver, particularly, when the early guys who translated wrote this stuff started teaching the local group, so we got a bit of a head start there. When the internet came along, of course, it exploded. Right from the very first mailing list, we started to get discussion groups going on the manuals, and related to that, we had access to modern training gear, which modern training gear, which lets us do something they couldn't do quite as well back then, which is fight each other. So we can look at the written material and say, oh, I think he's saying hit here, dodge, and then hit here. Let's try it out. Wow. Oh, that didn't work. Okay. Doing that with a sharp or regular chunk of steel, this, you know, taking a steel rod and hitting someone in the face is not a great way to learn. It causes issues. So having access to modern fencing masks, well-designed modern swords that you can hit somebody with that have a little bit of flex in them, so you can go for a beer afterwards instead of the hospital. This really helped us actually practice and test out the interpretations and see what made sense and what didn't make sense, which wound up giving us a really robust international community. I think it was last year, Sweden nationally recognized longsword fighting as a sport. So, yeah, it was pretty cool. We're working on Canada. We did contact the Olympics about that. Like, oh, that sounds amazing. We'll get back to you. Eventually. The study of medieval martial arts and Renaissance martial arts is something that's a really fast-growing new tradition that's building up. It's quite a bit of fun. Which leads us with a really interesting point of things that we're looking for in studying the medieval martial arts and what we bring forward into the modern ones is the concept of habitus. Habitus is one of those really interesting things. It's a way of encoding the somewhat subconscious ways that a fighter will carry themselves. Kaja is a good example here. Stand up. If I tell you Kaja is a ballet dancer, you're going to start to assume certain things about her. If she goes to pick something up, if she moves, if she's working out, you're going to assume certain things about how she carries herself. There'll be a certain ballet grace to her movements. These are things you assume. If I tell you that Kaja's background was an Olympic wrestler, suddenly you assume different things about her body posture and movement. This is what habitus is. So when we look at the medieval martial arts, we don't have access to that habitus anymore. It's gone from us, and this is a really important thing. Just to define habitus, first off, it's an acquired disposition. It's not something you're born with, it's something you pick up. It holds that practical mastery lies beneath consciousness and discourse. For example, if I'm teaching martial arts, when I want my students, when I want to see that they've mastered a technique, I'm not looking so much for the execution of the technique a certain way. I'm looking that they embody the habitus that we want our student to carry across. We think this study is not too hard for us. Other people have to deal with that. Well, you're not quite getting it. It also holds that a set of dispositions vary by social position and trajectory, which is not necessarily so important in martial arts practice. Is. And fourthly, it's malleable and transmissible because it results from pedagogical work, which is to say we can teach habitus. We can transmit habitus and it will carry from one student to the next. So with medieval martial arts, not having access to the habitus can cause some issues. For example, working with Achille Marazzo's manual from the early Renaissance, fusion of the original material and the interpretations indicated that a series of cuts were thrown with a rising cut, and then a falling cut, and then a second falling cut, which made sense and seemed a little weird. But I had a student who, as part of his natural habitus that he picked up in other fighting environments, would bring the sword up, translate down, and then do a quick flick of the wrist. It was really weird and strange. It was very effective in tournaments at the provincial championship. So when I went back to Moronzo and was looking at the material, I saw that this indication of a rising cut, a falling cut, and then another falling cut. If I, when I looked at that, went back to the original document and saw that it had been written down incorrectly. They had chosen, and I talked to the people who did it, they said, well, I looked at that description, it didn't make any sense to have a cut that did this and then this. Why would you do that? So I figured it was written down wrong and then reprinted 30 times correctly. But it just made no sense to anyone that you would do this until we saw someone actually have that haptus. Now we have that haptus, we can go back and say there's all this kind of flowing cuts. We need to re-examine all the work and find out where we're going with that. Which is really exciting. Right, so moving on. More haptus. I left myself a note, so I'm going to miss this part. So we aren't without any haptus. One thing we have discovered in our modern practice is that people who work with weapons in a certain format, that is, people who spar and fight each other with weapons, do have a common haptus. I can pick someone who's done longsword work in Europe, someone who does rapier work here in North America, and compare them to certain styles of Filipino martial arts that work exclusively with bladed weapons, not sticks. And then talk to some Japanese people that do steel sparring work. And we all kind of move the same way. Mm-hmm. We all share a lot in common. So we have that now. By looking at different cultures and seeing that that echoes what we understand of haptus, we can kind of make a little bit of assumption that maybe the medieval haptus was also similar. Yeah, at least it gives us an excuse to look a little deeper into what we see written. And looking a little deeper into that, we go back to I-33, and what we have here is images from the reprints, which show the same body postures and stuff. The last reprint was a 17th century one, actually. Parts of this manuscript were stolen. There's ripped up pages.
Yeah.
We think the ripped up pages were used to fill in other people's martial arts, and they just threw them out when they were done. But we know there's bits of the manual that show up in other ones. Okay, so we're going to get a little bit more on I-33, talking about the manual itself. It was written by a priest, we think, called Duturis. That is, there's a name scrolled on. We think it's his. We don't really know. There's also a note on there from one of the popes saying this is a terrible thing that priests do when they're really lazy. So that helped us date it a little bit. Okay, the manual itself.
Yeah.
Oh, do a thing. Okay, fantastic. I don't know what happened, but anyway, there's no picture. The manual itself includes a series of guards and counters to the guards, and it says these seven attacks are done by the common fencer. We have some guards, swords in one position, another position, and transitions through all of them. And then he proposes a system of obsessios, counters to the guards, that the nice priests do to demonstrate here is our technique and how we do the common fencer. It's really fun. It was written by, I think, three different scribes who write it, and 17 different artists worked on the illustrations. So it was a good bit of work by the Jewish priests. So the techniques itself, we'll look into one of the actual techniques. Okay, so the first thing we'll see is we see the priest is going to assume the first ward position. And this describes a general body of techniques where, again, the priest is being a common fencer. We're seeing how he's teaching the student to defeat common technique. So his first ward position shows cuts that will come from a certain path, and the buck will give him some protection from that. Kaja, as the student, will be in the obsessio of the half shield, which is also for reasons we're still arguing with each other over. So from the half shield, which is referred to as an obsessio, she's trying to draw an attack out. We see that next, the attack she's expecting is what's called falling under, which is also a weird thing. simple cut straight door down like so. And then you see the prepared counter, which is a bind against the counter. Isn't that nice? So as they start, they reset a little bit, and you'll see how Kaja had actually prepared for this in advance. There we go. Pretty simple, but nice and done. Thanks, guys. Now, okay, so our Indian things. Anyway, I will look at some of the pictures and tell you. We've got an example, great. So the following, the finishing action now is the student is going to knock down the mind sword and deliver her finishing blow to the priest. And that's our complete technique. I'm going to demonstrate it one more time. Voila. As you can see, it's a very effective technique. And this is martial arts of 13th length. That's how it's done.
I'm going to jump in here very quickly. More so than going, yes, that is exactly how this play is done. That is the canonical version of this thing. Those are the martial arts of the 14th century. What we're really showing here is how we go from these pictures, these images, the little bit of text description that we have. You can see that in many cases there's really not very much. We get like a little line of script. How we translate that into movement. So the play that we arrived at, you know, we've got four static images of guards, and we have our own physical understanding of how swords move. We have the fact that there's really only so many ways to swing a sword. The more different styles you study, the more treatises you read, the more you move from single-handed weapons to two-handed weapons, to long blades to short blades, you realize that there's really only so many ways to hit somebody with a chunk of metal and have it work. Armor was a factor, but the kinds of targets that we use against an unarmored opponent are actually very similar to the ones that we use against somebody who's wearing armor, because there's only so many places you can hit a human body and shut down effectively. So we end up seeing a lot of strikes to the same places that require the same kinds of cutting angles and the same kinds of motion. And if you moved a sword all the way up here, there's only so many ways to transition it to being over here. So you end up developing this common body of movement that you've kind of internalized. And when you come to interpret a play, it's relatively straightforward to use that tradition to figure out what the heck is going on in the plays.
Yeah. What are we talking about? Habits? How we're trying to interpret that from the place is we know how we use sword and buffer, we know how it works, but then looking for habit is cruising us. We're going to look for things like the posture of the legs. We're making some assumptions for art because my ankle is broken, so I can't have it sit like that. But there are specific things that talk to us in martial arts, primarily the exact center weighting, how the hips are between the feet. That's really unusual. Somewhat center-weighted, but then they have this hip hinge. This hip hinge forward we see in a lot of wrestling styles. So it does imply that there's a common background in wrestling to these people. And in later plays, which we're not getting into, you will actually see a considerable amount of grappling happens. The bone technique they use to not buffer them in that last way is sometimes done as a full wrap. We'll wrap the person around. Or they will spin them backwards and give a sort of kick in the butt before they come. Literally, like, it's a Yeah, we also look for the posture of the head, the turn of the head, how the arms are extended forward, things we can apply about the tilt of the body. All these things are pretty important to us in trying to understand what we apply to habit is. It's a real fun practice.
I'm going to talk a little bit about how we take the knowledge that we've developed playing around with these with
these didactic texts that were, for the most part, designed not necessarily to work as manuals the way that we think of manuals today, like they teach you how to operate a VCR. They're not meant to teach you how to operate a martial arts system, so to speak, but they do communicate a lot about a particular approach. We tend to think of them a little bit more like essays or treatises, where often what we have is a martial arts master who is not trying to communicate their entire teaching style, but is rather pursuing an idea or is trying to develop a particular notion of their own approach to fighting. That's why with something like MS 133, it starts out going, okay, so everybody does this. Now let me show you my particular approach to these few attacks and why that's better. So they already, they operate in discourse with one another. They already often have kind of a literary element to them. And what we decided to do for this presentation, when Rob asked us to come in, was to think about how we can apply some of that same methodology, that same thinking, that same understanding, that physical understanding of swordplay to some of the romances. So what I did a little while ago is started digging through a fairly small corpus of texts. I chose to limit myself to sort of 13th to 15th century pieces and ones that were available in the team's online resource because it's wonderful. And you'll notice that quite a few of the texts that we talk about, or that I was looking at here, show up in the outline manuscript, which we've got. Excellent. Play the room. So the outline we've got dated to roughly the 1330s in terms of composition, which makes it a contemporary of MS 133, which we know was responding to kind of a broader cultural martial tradition. So that's not to say that everything that's in the outline text features people who are fighting exactly like the monks in 133, but rather that they're operating in a shared martial culture, and that the way people fight, the way people move, the way that combat operates probably has some amount of commonality. So that's exciting. And what I did when I started looking at these romances is I tried to pin down what a romance fight actually looks like, whether we've got some common features that we can pull out of all of the many combats that occur in these seven texts. And I started with equipment. What arms and armor are our fighters using? And we get this really, really great passage from Ewain Gawain. This is Ewain's big fight against the Knight of the Well, that in a fairly short span of lines kind of tells us everything that they've got on. These fights always begin with, or almost always begin with, a mounted clash. We've got knights on horses, they've got spears or lances. The text is ambiguous and we know that both were used. They've got shields, they're wearing helmets, they're wearing hauberks, and partway through what's going on, they will transition from using the spears to fighting the sword and shield. And this really nice bit from Bevis kind of gives us a rundown of how the armor is working. Got hauberk and shield that happened to be in the veil, he's not worth a platoon, that he may fail to the boot. And that's from Bevis's fight against Red of the Moon right before he jumps into the ocean on his horse. So we've got these kind of three layers of armor that should be between the knight and certain death, the sword. So we know he's wearing hauberk, which is a chain. Piece of armor, they were either kind of thigh or knee length, or you sometimes someone's that came considerably further down. We've got the shield that's held out in front and should be providing substantial protection. And then we've got an akaton, which is a padded jacket. And those are partially worn for comfort because chainmail is heavy and pinchy and awful. But they actually also provide a substantial amount of protection. And we do, not from this period, but we do actually have attestations of cloth armor. I have a friend who's a fabric arts scholar, and she's actually working on a reproduction of full cloth. know that cloth alone, if it was very heavily quilted and padded and layered, was actually able to stop a sword. So this is kind of what we're looking at in terms of armaments. And conveniently enough, this is our Abermouth bodice. He's pretty much wearing exactly what we would expect. We've got the helm, we've got the hauberk, we can see that he's got both a sword and a shield, or a sword and a spear, rather. He doesn't have a shield, but he has one in all of his armor. So this is kind of our physical context. Let's talk about targeting, because targeting is fun. and because one of the things about all of these romance fights is that they're big and dramatic and gory, and there's blood everywhere. And yet, people are only kind of getting hit in a few very specific ways. So from Ami and Alun, we get the helm and the side, or the this part of the trunk, as sort of our primary targets. Blood gore. in the Bevis fight, and that is when Bevis is returning from his hunt fairly early on in the text, and he's waylaid by the steward and a whole bunch of his men. Bevis is on foot, everybody else is on horses, and we have this quick little description, and some upon the helm that hit into the saddle he had slid. So there's kind of two different ways we can read that. If it's a single action, then we have people who are being struck in the head and sort of cleaved in half all the way down to the saddle. And then they fall off and presumably they're not much trouble anymore. And we know that was a thing that happened, but it's kind of interesting to read this as two separate actions as well. If we're dealing with a knight who's on foot, dealing with an opponent who's up on horseback, stabbing upward around the saddle into the groin area is an extremely, extremely effective way of, first of all, getting through somebody's armor. Second of all, attacking a target that is much more accessible than the upper parts of the body. And third of all, pretty much guaranteed killing them, because those are moves that one cannot turn a key very effectively and which will bleed out very fast. So we've got the head, we've got the side, we've got potentially the groin. The next kind of strike that we see from our judicial duel in Ami and Alun is a strike that comes down through the shoulder and enters into the chest. A lot of times these are killing blows. That's the case in this text. We see it again in a number of fights in Bevis. And this is something that we return to again and again and again. At the very end, we've got a fight, a big sort of set piece fight between Oliver and Ferengras in this ultimate battle. And we kind of get a lot of these components all combined. We've got the helm, we've got the hauberk that bursts asunder in some fashion. We've got a cut down into the side of the body, and then we have the requisite guts everywhere. So you can see that although there's a lot of different descriptions of battle, there's actually only so many places on the body that are being affected. And these are very, 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 very similar in our manuals. So this is a plate from Fury Blueberry's Flower of Battle. This particular edition is from 1409. And the image of the swords on that human figure is showing how you're going to target your cuts. So we've got two big diagonal descending blows to the shoulders. We've got two horizontal blows that are coming in at the center line of the torso. We've got two rising cuts that are again coming at the side. And we've got one coming straight up the middle at the groin. The head's not a target in this particular image, but we know that it's a very common one in these texts. And we also know that this is something that wasn't just specific to one system. Once again, there's only so many ways you can get somebody to sword. This is a much later diagram. This is from Chivalric's Opera Nova, which is from 1536 in this edition. And we have the same cutting lines. The cuts that are being described are coming in diagonals to the body, diagonals rising up, side to side, coming up the middle, and they've added two descending blows that come down sort of parallel to the head. This is for a style of fighting that employs the sword in one hand. The Fiore diagrams for the sword in two hands, that may account for some of the targeting differences. A big descending blow down to the head with a two-handed sword is
reality of how people are being hit in the romances that conforms with what we know from how they got hit in real films.
And then there's all the embellishment, some of which is for show to make these stories big and dramatic and fun or really heroic, and some of which tells us, again, a little bit about what's going on twice. So sparks flying from helmets, it's shiny, it's exciting, people are getting their head. The blood in Hero 2 amounts is, it's a little bit silly, but it does tell us that over the course of a combat, the knights are taking a decent number of non-lethal wounds. That it's not a case of swords going clang, 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 and then one person gets hit and it's over. There is a back and forth here that involves people being injured. This is something that, this is a style of fighting that allows people to sustain a fair amount of damage before the fight actually ends. So there is something useful in that, I guess. Shields getting cut to pieces. Very common, as far as I can tell, they were made out of balsa wood. because every fight description we get there's at least a quarter of a shield lost. And again, part of this is, look, our hero is so strong that he can make a shield explode. That is absolutely part of what's being conveyed. But it also tells us a lot about the role that the shield is fulfilling in the fight, that it is out there as a primary mode of defense, that it is the thing that is taking force. Fights last at least 6 hours. Ooh. Sorry, I got ahead of myself. Knights getting unhorsed. Very common. As far as we can tell, anytime you get hit with a spear, you will immediately fall off the horse. we're aligning that today because we were not able to bring in horses and perform into combat. but it gives us a sense of progression to the fights, that they always begin on horseback and they always end on foot. There are very, very few exceptions to this. Fights that last at least 6 hours, as an absolute bare minimum. again, there is that element of exaggeration here, but it kind of fits with the blood everywhere trope, that we know that these went on for a little while, that this isn't just a single clash, but rather an ongoing engagement. It also gets a little bit fun if we treat it as a literary trope, because it shows up a lot in our earlier romances and has been exaggerated to the point of ridiculousness by the time we get to the later ones. To the point where in our fight between Oliver and Ferrenbrass and the Sultan of Babylon, which is, I think, the latest piece that I was looking at for this, they actually stop for a break through the fight, and they sit down under a tree, and they have a chat. And when they decide they're really not going to resolve their differences, they go back to fighting. So this is something that has become such a common feature of these kinds of fights that we're making fun of it by the time we get to the 15th century. And that brings me to kind of an important point of transmission, that there's a mix of things going on here in these romance descriptions. We know that this is a genre that is full of tropes. We know that this is a genre in which copying and repetition and drawing on similar traditions is super common. So I'm not suggesting here that the fact that the same things show up in the text is purely due to the martial aspect of things. Tropes exist. There's definitely literary aspects to this. But I do think it's interesting that the little bits that do tend to show up again and again and again in these texts have the same kind of martial aspect. A lot of these fight descriptions are incredibly short. The next chunk I've got, the next piece I've got is from Sir Isambras, which is not primarily sort of combat-centric as a romance, and the one battle that we really do get described is, it's like 15 lines. It is an incredibly short piece, and it's sort of, Isambras went and he fought against the Sultan and it was really good and he proved himself right. And even in a piece that short, we still have to hit certain things. We again have that hitting people on the head and then cutting them all the way in half. There are these sort of touchstone images that show up in these very short descriptions that are just kind of the highlights of a proper fight. So from all of this, what I'd like to do is kind of reconstruct what we might call a generic romance fight. That manuscript image is just a part for fun because it is one of my very, very, very favorites. If anybody's interested in this, is Rich
British Library, MS Royal 12F13. It's from about the mid 15th century. As far as we know, horses didn't ride. But the arms and armor are appropriate to the period of the fall of time. So if we were going to have kind of a generic fighting romance, if you were composing a romance and you needed to just briefly signify that combat had occurred and it went the way that it usually goes, we have a couple common features. We know that they'd start off on horses and they end up fighting with sword and shield. We know that our primary targets, the places where the blows would be coming in, would be our head, our sides, and the shoulder. We know that it would go on for a while, that there would be multiple non-lethal wounds taken, probably by both sides. Shields would go kablooey. And the killing blow would really be one of two things. It's either going to be a debilitating head wound or sometimes a decapitation, or it's going to be a shoulder strike that comes down into the torso. So what I'm going to do now is I'm going to ask my lovely assistants here to show us what that might look like. We haven't rehearsed a fight in advance. What I'm wanting to show here is, among other things, our method of interpretation and how we kind of look at these things. So both of our fighters here are very experienced. They've been working with these swords, with these weapons for 7 years, 25 years. And this is something, these are tools that they work with every day. These are the parameters of a fight. Shows with that. That is naturally going to fall around the head or neck area because of the way that our weapons are. So this is our general kind of romance fight. And now what I want to do is dig into something a little bit more specific, and also suggest ways in which this kind of interpretation, this kind of physical approach to these parts of the tests, can maybe actually help us translating work as literature scholars rather than just as martial artists. So this is one of the later moments in Bev's Hampton. This is the final duel between Bevis and Ivor. And it's a little bit unusual. This is, once again, this is the team's edition of Bevis, so this is working exclusively from the Alchemon one. Bevis is unusual in general in that, as a romance, it tends to pay a lot more attention to the details of combat than a lot of the other texts that I mentioned, or that I looked at. As I mentioned, texts like Isambras or even Gowther, which is a very violent text, is certainly not disinterested in combat. They don't tend to get into a lot of the detail of what's actually happening in a fight. They'll give you those signposts. They'll give you those generic sort of signs of, yes, yes, a fight's happening. Clang, clang, helmets, shields, somebody's head got chopped off. Great. Bevis goes into substantially more detail, and this fight in particular is very interesting. So we start off in that first section. They
riding each other on their horses. Spears go through shields into hauberks. Belts explode. They both fall off of their mounts, and they realize that at this point they're going to have to fight on foot. So that's where we come in here. And we've kind of got a nice setting of the scene at the beginning, that they spring out of their saddles, they fling together with powerful strokes, and helm and shield and bassinet are all sort of sending off sparks. So there's a nice setting of the tone of the intensity of this fight. This goes on, we are told, from pre until midday, so we've got our minimum 6 hours. And then finally at noon, somebody does something interesting. And I've cut a large section where effectively the peanut gallery is talking about whether they think that a certain person is going to win the fight. So at high midday, the king Ivor throws a big, powerful strike at Bettis that cuts through the circlet of gold he's wearing and hews through the visor of his helmet, shaves off half of his beard, but doesn't actually touch him. And this makes Bettis rather unhappy. And so he makes his first substantial attack against Ivor. And we have him reaching out with his sword and cutting into the shoulder. And we actually goes in half a foot. We've got like a very specific description of just how bad this wound is. And we're also told that it's severe enough to drive Ivor to his knees from the pain. Ivor is now very angry, so he jumps up. There's a lot of getting hurt, getting mad at the other guy in this fight. And he starts up and starts raining down blows on Bettis, who is able to defend himself with his shield. And we have this really lovely moment from a tactical perspective, where we hear, and Ivor with a stroke of arrow made fly into the river a large quarter of his shield that never massed a town to yield. Or Ivor might his hand withdraw, Bettis then to Christian law, with Morgulai smote him though that his shield he cleft the toe, and his left hand by the wrist. It flew away from the Chris. which is the best part. But we actually have a moment where we're told that Ivor has effectively overextended himself. That he throws this enormous, powerful blow, and before he's able to withdraw, before he's able to recover from the action that he's taken, Bevis seizes the opportunity and he strikes him. You read that as a martial artist, and you're like, yup. but that's a level of tactical detail that isn't very common in these kinds of tasks. So Ivor has lost his shield arm, his left hand, and he's very angry, and he's throwing even larger, even more dangerous cuts at Bevis, who once again is able to just kind of hunker down behind his shield and defend himself. And then Bevis gets in one last attack that takes Ivor's right hand and his shoulder bone, and ends the fight. Because at this point, Ivor has no hands. And is also presumably leading to death. So there's a really nice back and forth to this description. There's a very nice progression. We've got some tactical details that have been given to us. And all of that together gives us enough meat that maybe we can actually kind of recreate it. So, King Ivor and Bevis Canton are going to armor up, and what they're going to show us right now is sort of the description that I'm just giving you, the way that it's been traditionally interpreted, lost, translated. So again, this is pretty much improvised. I'm going to be giving our players cues as to what bit of the little back and forth is happening. And they're going to try to keep this as natural to their own fighting as possible. So, you guys ready? So we've got Ivor in black. Your right hand pose. Bevis, whose beard is unfortunately hidden under his and they're going to spring out of their saddles and start flinging away with their swords. What I noticed as I was working through this, because I wanted to quickly translate it into language so that my fighters would have an understanding of what the heck was going on, is that the common translation, the common gloss of one of the lines in this, made sense if you were going by the metric and the example set by earlier bits of the poem, but perhaps didn't make as much sense if one was a sword fighter and was thinking about how one would conduct oneself in such an event. So what I'm focusing on is the last moments of this fight, when Ivor, he has one arm now, he's attacking Bevis at the very end, and Bevis just barely manages to defend himself before counterattacking. And we've got the line, "He kept his stroke with his targe," which has been glossed as Bevis defending or blocking Ivor's strikes with Bevis's sheet. Because all we get are a whole bunch of pronouns, so it can be a little bit ambiguous. And what we get is something like what we saw in the fight there, where Randy spent a substantial amount of time kind of hunkered down behind his shield being driven backwards. And that's real nice and dramatic, and kind of fits with that sense of back and forth that we have to the fight. But when I asked Randy to actually do this during sparring, he looked at me like I was a crazy person. because that's something that you could potentially do if the onslaught was particularly ferocious. But you don't generally just defend in a sword fight. It's very, very, very rare to take actions that only do one. That offense and defense are consistently combined. And so there's potentially another way of glossing this, where Ivor is still super angry, he's still coming at Bevis as hard as he possibly can. But it's Bevis who is throwing counterstrikes this entire time. And what he's doing is he's keeping his shield together with his sword as he throws these attacks, and he can just show us real quick how one moves. Generally speaking, when one has a shield in one hand and a sword in the other, our two weapons move as a unit. And one could argue that the tactical error that Ivor made earlier, that moment of overextension, wasn't just that he reached too far forward, that he attacked too aggressively, but was also the fact that he, in doing so, separated his weapons. That's what creates potentially an opening to the body, to a strike through the center line, but that's also what makes that left arm, that shield hand, actually vulnerable. If he's keeping it in close together with a sword, it's a lot less likely for it to be struck. So let's have that fight again. And let's have it now with Bevis fighting the way that a fighter comfortable with sword and shield combat was a bit more likely to be. All right, they jump off their horses and they start fighting. But this is how we deal with text. This is how we workshop our material. we look at an image or a text that we've been given and go, okay, so it's been traditionally translated this way, or this is my first reading of this material, let's try it out. And then we do it, and one of our funders goes, nope, that felt weird and that didn't work. Or I've seen people trying to move from one plate image to another and realizing that it, to follow the illustrations exactly would involve passing through somebody else's home. So we use that physical movement, we use our own habitus, our own understanding of how swords work, to find our own understanding of how these things happen. So I'm not necessarily suggesting that the second translation that I proposed is better or more accurate or truer to the text, because again, we're dealing with a literary text and there are things at play here that are not just would this actually work in a fight. But our approach, our knowledge of how combat works gives us access to an alternate interpretation. And I find that rather interesting. And I wanted to take a minute and kind of think about whether this translation changes anything from a literary perspective. It doesn't change much, but it gives us a bit of a different flavor to the fight. In sort of version one, we have angry, angry Eivor and Bevis kind of hunkering down behind his shield and being driven back. There's a nice dramatic sense of back and forth. There's a sense that our hero is in legitimate peril, that he is being threatened, that this is an important fight. The stakes are very, very high. But it also makes Bevis kind of rapid fire. If we take the other approach, if not only do we kind of make him a little bit better tactically, the other thing we do if we have him fighting with this particular style of sort of shield combat is that we bring his fighting style more in line with what we know was being practiced in Christian Europe at the time, that was being taught by people in religious institutions. If we come back to MS 33, Bevis isn't just the better fighter in this context. Eivor literally gets chopped to pieces, so either way, Bevis is doing really well. But given that this is a text that is very, very concerned with ideas of national and religious identity, given that this specifically is a fight in which we have a Christian fighting a Saracen, and in which there is discussion, like the fight ends with Bevis trying to convince Eivor to convert, and Eivor going, no, screw you, and Bevis chopping off his head. given all of that, it could potentially add something to our reading if we understand that Bevis is fighting like a Christian and like, well, the manuscript was German, so not quite an Englishman, but then Bevis isn't really quite an Englishman anyway. So what I'm hoping to gesture towards with this kind of physicalized reading is that being able to come at these texts from that material, from that martial perspective, can potentially illuminate them as literary pieces as well. And that's kind of going to bring us to the close here. So why interpret romance combat? Why do what we just did beyond the fact that things go climbing as well? I think physicality and habitus are quite important to romances. These are very physical texts. We have all of these descriptions of blood and guts. We have all of these descriptions of bodies, of how people are shaped, of how they move, of whether they fit into the spaces that they're supposed to be in or not. So it makes sense for us to consider them as physical spaces. The way that these mates behave, the way that they physically carry themselves, their habitus as martial Christian men is very important to their characterization. It informs thematic issues in the text. And it's also very interesting as a marker of kind of the cultural cues that the audience is trying to absorb. If we're looking at the later romances as texts that are being read or worked on by kind of a middle class that's aspiring to these ideals of knighthood, we know that they're looking for the trappings of this. They're looking for all of the shiny bits for the heraldry. They're also going to be looking for the physicality of knighthood and of kind of, oh, chivalry is a word I hate, but it's what I need to use right now. We're also at a very interesting point in time right now where we have people in the Western martial arts tradition who practice sword fighting on a daily basis, who don't go to battle and die every day. There are artifacts to a lot of our fighting that do come from training in a controlled environment. But we have access to houses of sword fighter once again. We have people who do live by the sword. We have people who train in order to become better sword fighters and who have an intuitive physical understanding of a lot of how these things work that we didn't really have 30 or 40 years ago. So we're kind of at a really nice cultural moment where we can start looking at these things from a different perspective again. To kind of look at it bilaterally, I think as literary scholars, as people that are looking at these pieces primarily as texts, looking at those romance combats as potential martial arts artifacts gives us a new lens for literary interpretation that's really rooted in the physical culture of that era. And can give us little small moments of translation or interpretation or perspective that might tell us a little bit more about what a particular text is doing and how it's embedded in its own culture. From our perspective as martial artists, this is also a really nice place to access not necessarily the techniques or the tactics of fighters in that period, but their habits, the way that they carried themselves, the kind of ideals of conduct in a fight, or movement, or interaction with their opponent that carried forward. Because when we have these short little condensed descriptions that are just clang, clang, smash, smash, guy gets arm chopped off, he's dead, that's a shorthand. And that's a shorthand that for, you know, members of the audience who were fighters, who did do this on a regular basis, is gonna be enough that they can kind of reconstruct a mental picture of the fight. It's enough that we can do it, so certainly they were able to. And knowing what gets used as shorthand, knowing what is used there to kind of signify what's happening, tells us about what these people had internalized. It tells us about how they already knew, what they already knew, what was sort of the commonplace martial culture of their time. And that's incredibly useful to us as martial artists. So that's what we had to share with you today. We actually got quite a bit of time still. If I'd like to open the floor to any questions or comments or further discussion, unless Rob has other ideas.
Well, I think we'll start by thanking all three of you for that fascinating time. So, we have questions.
I have one. Thank you, first of all. That was fabulous. So, I was wondering about Ivor's shield hand getting cut off, which seemed kind of awkward when you were just now doing it, which, of course, could be because you hadn't, you know, scripted it out. But it made me wonder how natural it would be to target a shield hand rather than a sword hand, if you have a sense of that. I'm not a martial artist, so my assumption would be you'd focus on the sword hand, which is actually what you were doing. But I just wondered about that.
Yeah, I can actually quickly show you. There are three ways to attack the shield hand. These are small bumpers. It's a little different when you're using a larger shield, but the principles go fairly well. What I would do if I was aiming for a sword hand from this point of view is first off, I can just hit right through there. If he's got slightly wrong alignment, if he's not paying attention, I'm able to lower up through and get the forearm off. But if I want to get the hand itself, especially with a steel buffer like this, I'm looking for a separation between the shield and the buffer. As soon as that separation happens, then I'm able to access the inside, and if he just rolls, you see that goes right through the wrist bone.
Yeah.
That's an easy sever of the hand. I would drop off the bone. And also, if he's using a larger shield, the other technique for that is we will come around from the backside like that and sever right from the knife. And that'll work if he's even like a large cut shield. So we'll improve it.
So the angles are a little bit different, and then we've actually got them as kind of going right through it. I wouldn't really do that. But I guess you could. but yeah, there are some kind of artifacts where angulation happens.
Elizabeth? I have a further question about shields and also about left-handedness. Mm-hmm. So when, for instance, Lancelot offers to fight Meleagon with one hand tied behind his back, presumably that's a seriously dangerous offer. Protection. And I'm interested in your take on that. If you don't have a shield, if you literally only have one hand to fight with, you're very exposed. And
yes.
yes, and no. The sword itself acts as a very effective shield. If you're trained correctly in the use of the sword, the cutting actions itself. You see, in Achille Morasso's manual, he says the single sword is, and Fiore as well says the single sword is a queen of weapons. It is the prevalent show of skill, because when you hold the blade like so, and any attack coming in, you're able to actually
enjoy
it. That's actually one of my favorite technical applications of swordplay. Just give him a small extension. For as he's coming forward, I can throw a parry against his blow that also hits him. And all of our single sword use is going to take me placing my blade up in line against his sword. We see this in modern defense with these nice small actions, but when you've got edge dominant blades, it's really easy to do that with the sword and knock it right down out of the way. So we have to be more aware of momentum that drives up as I cut things up. I want to be able to get this nice parry. It's a good thing this is a modern blade, the next ham. Otherwise, I'd have some tasty fingers to try it for the barbecue later. But we're always looking to throw blows that intersect the incoming blow and try to strike the opponent at the same time. It's a very well developed sword like
Slot. So if you're not Slot, it doesn't matter if you're already fighting.
Yeah, she's a really good fighter, I guess. So, there is definitely no one single sword styles that work extremely well. Shield is a tremendous advantage. It's a whole other layer to put together. Fighting someone single sword against sword and shield would be difficult.
So we can read that as Lancelot showing off.
Yes. This is not to do with romance, but it's said that there's a Scottish family who are both really left-handed, and that the spiral staircases in their castles were all made the opposite way than usual, so they would fight up with their left hand. I mean, I don't know, but are we aware of left-handedness? Is it mentioned in your manual? Does it come
up?
Yes.
For a little bit of context, both Jordan and myself are left-handed fighters, and there's actually an unusually large number of us at our school, so Randy has actually been looking through the manuals for ways of dealing with us. And that brings us to Vienna, who is a 17th century?
Yes.
Yeah. 17th century Spanish swordsman who he's working with rapier. And is working within the Spanish martial tradition, which we call destreza. And you memorize much better than I have what he says about left-handed people.
They're evil. They lack honor. They're a result of the parents' terrible upbringing, and the parents don't have honor as well. If they've got a brain, you can teach them out of it in no time at all. But if they refuse to be taught out of it, then they're evil.
It's actually an extreme.
It goes on for like 6 pages.
Yeah, it's a really odd interjection into what is otherwise a very—it's a fairly clinical, mathematical sort of treatise—and all of a sudden you get this rant about how left-handed people are terrible and you should never have them as students unless you can maybe beat it out of them so that they can fight like a proper right-handed person. His techniques, incidentally, work just fine with the left hand, but the counters with a left-on-right are a little bit of a challenge. My pet theory is that I just didn't like fighting against left-handed people because his perfect math was less beautiful in that context. And so he decided to take it as a personal benefit. So we know that there were left-handed fighters. All of the manuals that we see are taught from the perspective of a right-handed fighter facing another right-handed fighter, with some exceptions.
With some exceptions. The Italian tradition from there's always a section that has to deal with the left hand defense. And actually, to be fair, Biennial does begin the section with left hand defense by saying everyone thinks the Valkyries are going to kick through the butt because they have a natural advantage. But no, it's not true because there are arrows in the
That was just fascinating. I immediately am running through all of the romance combats I can think about. And do you remember that moment in Mallory? It's early on in the adventures of Lancelot the Hapless, where the lady tricks him up the tree because she says a bird is stuck and it's actually a plot to kill him. And he has to fight, and he's left his, he doesn't have his weapon. And he fights with a stick, and he wins. And I just always thought it was just sort of silly exaggeration, but you're saying that you can actually fight with a stick.
Yeah, Fury teaches him.
Because he has always got his stick. And then later, isn't he completely naked with nothing but a sheep? He fights his way out of the
He defeats one of the knights, drags him inside, and then arms himself with the dead knight's armor because he knows it's such a disadvantage.
Well, and I mean, to be fair, we have a moment, even in the romances we were talking about, that fight, that Bevis and Hampton fight where he's off on the boar hunt and then he has to fight the steward. That starts with him having nothing but the boar's head on a stick.
Yeah.
And he ends up winning his great sword, Morgulay, from the steward, presumably by way of using the said boar's head on a stick. That bit is completely elided in the text. But sticks. they're often used as training tools alongside swords. The movements, the cutting patterns, the body mechanics are quite similar. And properly hardened wood can actually do pretty damn well against a steel weapon. Especially if you're able to position yourself so that you're striking against the flat of the blade rather than catching the edge. And if you do catch the edge the same way that you can do with a wooden sword, or a wooden shield rather, that was a little on the soft side, that actually gives you opportunities for disarms. If a sword gets stuck inside something like a wood stick, all of a sudden you have this point of contact and control that a sword fighter is really not going to be prepared for, because the nice thing with swords is that they don't generally stick to each other. They bind a little bit when they're sharp. That's one of the artifacts of our modern training that we're quite aware of and why we work with sharp swords every once in a while. Is the blunted blades, you'll notice they bounce right off of each other. As soon as there's contact, they just kind of go. With a fully sharpened blade, they stick just a teeny tiny bit. So there's a slightly different dynamic to how they move it. When you're dealing with a stick versus a sword, that would sort of be dramatically accentuated. You could potentially use it to your advantage.
I think there's a trope that I like to
want a medical doctor here, but there are veins and things in the artery. femoral artery is 20 seconds. That I know. That this is a smaller blood vessel than the femoral artery, okay? But how long can this fight possibly go on? I mean, Igor, this is a power play. I mean, you're ditching your goalie and going for whatever you Igor wants to kill Bevis before he dies himself, but it's going to be a Pyrrhic victory. And literarily, but before you do the technical side of this, literarily, this fight seems like it goes on and on and on, but time is going to slow down. They're going to do more description for this final bit where Igor is maddened and wounded and missing a hand. And all the description beforehand happens much more slowly because the battle goes on a long time. And then you've got roughly the same amount of description for the final stuff that can't take more than a minute or so.
Yeah, it's actually even more dramatic than that. If we look at this, the first 6 hours of the fight are those first six lines. And all of the rest of it, as far as we can tell, probably happens in about as much time as we demonstrated. Medically, I think Igor's probably got about 2 minutes.
Okay.
Adrenaline is amazing. and humans vary dramatically in how they react to shock and blood loss. So say a maximum of 2 minutes. But yeah, this is absolutely a really interesting kind of zooming in where all of a sudden we get a blow by blow. In cases where we don't otherwise, even when similar moments happen in other texts. Oliver and Fremros is fighting the Sultan of Babylon. By the end of it, Fremros literally has his guts hanging out, and they still kind of sit down and have a nice conversation. So the timing is interesting. But yeah, the level of detail is really
interesting.
Guts,
you could manage. You're in pain, and guts really are not nearly as essential as intact arteries.
One thing we
it would take hours to die of gut.
There's been a fair bit of research on this lately, talking to a number of doctors, and some of the wounds you'd actually be able to keep fighting for up to an hour. Well, we've got the one that would be actually difficult, I think, would be a blow coming this side down. The first one is a scar 6 inches, so not the seventh subclavian artery. And that one would put you down pretty quick. Getting your hand cut off, you could probably deal with that, and getting your other shoulder cut off. We've got lots of accounts of people having large losses like that, severing blows and shaving blows and things like that. People can last a long time. This is from emergency room doctors.
But you'd have to do something about it. You'd have to cauterize
it. It does help a lot. We find things like, if you don't want to put things on there, but you'll see things where people are stabbed multiple times in the heart and are able to run a few miles. There's friends of course. Some instinct going over the daily habits for up to half an hour before lying down and then succumbing to the wounds. Human body to be hungry.
Really interesting to the material culture.
Our school is interested in sort of a living, continuing martial arts tradition. So one of the things that we're very happy to do is take advantage of modern equipment and modern innovations when possible. So when we are modifying our equipment or choosing different tools, which we do all the time because people get their gear, it's generally how well does this serve my purposes in a modern context. If we're doing scholarship, if we're looking at interpreting a particular bit of material, we might choose our tools differently. And we also have colleagues in the martial arts community that are more very, very specifically interested in recreating and preserving a particular tradition. And they will often go to substantial lengths to recreate the conditions under which that was trained. Everything from clothing to footwear to armor. The weapons that we all use are generally fairly accurate reproductions. The weapons are the thing you really kind of don't mess with. But yeah, often people will put in a substantial amount of work to do things like fighting in leather-soled shoes. Oh, actually, yeah. quick note on the swords that we were using today. These are rapier-ish swords. They're lighter single-handed swords. And this particular model with its sort of wider base and dramatically tapered blade was designed specifically for training in the distressed tradition of rapier. We brought them in today because they're lighter than some of the very big and noisy ones that we use. But these were actually developed in partnership between one of the biggest scholars of destreza in North America and a sword manufacturer called Dorkwood Armory to fit the specifications of that particular training system as closely as possible. We found them incredibly useful in other applications as well, and to a certain extent, a sword is a sword is a sword. But these swords here are actually a really nice case of fighters going to substantial lengths to produce equipment that would kind of draw them closer to the context in which they are practicing. At least.
We are running out of time for questions, but before we thank our speakers again, Kaja and Jordan and Randy will be joining us at the banquet tonight, so if you have any more questions, you can ask them over a glass of wine or three.